Well, let's start with the title, Singing the Pictures. Can you explain the title?
Yeah, it was taken from a book by William Burroughs, the American author. And in those days, I read everything I could find by him and about him, and that had to do with how he constructed his books, because it is so much about montage techniques, you know, montage and cut-up technique that he invented, or he used it extensively. And I thought it was, well, I found the title really, I think it's a line from his book, The Wild Boys. And I thought it was really good to, as a sort of homage to use that quotation as a title for this piece.
Okay. How did you know William Burroughs?
I think in those days, I can't remember. I think via Jack Kerouac, I got to know all those names, and Allen Ginsberg and Burroughs. And I think the rudeness of Burroughs, and also is the combination of avant-garde technique and the hard-boiled crime style that he used with those short pieces of text where you find yourself almost thrown back into Raymond Chandler like environments, and then that alternated with these extremely strange and violent episodes where, with all those great titles like Steely Dan, for instance, is also taken from one of his books. Groups, well, Soft Machine, also taken from Burroughs. There's another, I think even Dead Fingers Talk is also a group. Mm-hmm. So he was a major influence on, I think Kerouac had to do with jazz, and Allen Ginsberg was really a hippie hero, and Burroughs was very much loved by the punk culture. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the word his rudeness and also the violent periods in his work. What is it that attracts you in that violent rude?
But maybe a sort of dynamic. You on the one hand, you are part of a story, and then suddenly it gets disrupted by a sort of outburst. And I thought it had a dynamic quality. I mean, I'm not interested in violence as a means or anything, or violence like in movies, like old crime movies. It's not about the violence, but about a sort of tension and about dynamics. That is the real interest.
So it's not the psychology of it, but more...
No, because in music there is no psychology. You know, there's only sound and how sound follows another sound. But I think music is always about music.
Okay. So you're in that...
Stravinsky-like,
The cut-ups of William Burroughs, of course, you mentioned them. Maybe I can connect this to the article you once wrote for a Dutch magazine about contemporary music called The Principle of Montage.
Yeah.
So montage and the way in which the way to connect several parts of music together, I hope I say it correctly, are very important for you, the way to organize music.
Yeah, the way how you connect small blocks of music together, how you chain those events together.
Blocks.
Yeah, sort of blocks. That was, of course, when I was very much into that way of thinking, whereas later on, and now it's there are other things that that are necessary. But then I was very influenced by Varese, which is of course also a music of blocks, mm-hmm. and especially pieces like Arcana. I was very influenced by that, and that whole those ideas about how you come from one part of music into the other.
Is it more, I try to get for myself clear what you mean by blocks, is it more a way of horizontal, instead of horizontal thinking, more vertical thinking?
Yeah, I think it's more vertical. Yeah.
Chords and so forth are very important.
Chords and loud attacks, especially in those days, that was my main, one of the main ingredients.
Okay.
And how you place those attacks in time, and how you hopefully get it to that it becomes a continuity. Mm-hmm. So it's not only stop or anything, but it's a continuous line of attacks. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, it's a horizontal flow.
In that article that I mentioned, you also mentioned people like, Giga Vertov and Sergei Eisenstein, who were very important for the Russian cinema in the beginning of last century. Those were also, you could say, more or less political artists. They had political goals with how they used montage.
Yeah.
Was that very important for you too?
Well, it was for them a big inspiration. But with films, you are connected to reality. You know, you do, like Vertov wanted to show reality without interference of a real director. You know, he didn't want to compose reality, but wanted to stay as closely as possible to the real world.
Yes.
And when you do music, it's the only thing you can connect with those artists is their way of how they use rhythm in their films, how fast they go, and especially with Vertov, that is an aspect that you can actually adapt. And I thought when I saw those films, I'm going to do that as well. Mm-hmm. And the timing is the only real connection between film and music, because in music there is no, in films you have this content, but in music there's a totally different content. You know, there's only sound and there's no reality.
So you wouldn't agree with me if I say that chords are in a way also content, musical content.
Yeah, musical content. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But they are not. There's no relationships to reality like in Vertov, where he shows workers in the streets and trams driving down the streets.
When you start writing a piece like Singing the Pictures, do you have already a clear image of what it must become?
No, I always started with a very vague and very small ideas. You know, I think, yeah, that piece I developed from a small sort of cell of cells of intervals, very much like Webern, because that was the way Webern was able to generate pieces from those rows. I thought was really interesting, and it took me a really long time to actually get the material in the way I really wanted it. So I had to, at least very many months I threw away material, and then only later on I could connect those cells into a real sort of musical language, and then came the form of the music. So from a grain of sand, I make a brick. Instead of a broad general idea, which is taken down into smaller steps. I mean, I always think from tiny, vague elements. That's my starting point.
It's the same way as Boulez works.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, I thought he was in a. I thought it was the opposite. With
also, it's a small cell.
Yeah.
And from that cell, he also compared it often with with a plant or a tree.
Yeah.
Tree has how do you say that? Takken. Huh?
Yeah, branches.
Branches, yeah. And they go all the way, but they are connected to what's in the ground.
Yeah, exactly. That's why with those pieces I could never incorporate anything else but these, but this basic material, mm-hmm. And from that I could really construct everything. And later on, with electronic music, I was able to add, for instance, voices from movies. You know, also, I mean, material that I hadn't invented myself. Mm-hmm. So that was a very different experience.
Yes. I can imagine, and if you write for a group like HOKETUS, which you were part of course, but they had a very special sound.
Yeah.
That when you start writing for that group, that you have this sound in your head.
Yeah, that was also the case with me, and the challenge was for me because I didn't want to write minimal music, because it's just not part of my real interest.
Yes.
I've never done it, or maybe later on when I got into techno, that there are repetitive elements, but in my instrumental music I wasn't interested in that, so I had to think of other means of doing something for the group which would be not minimal music, but also that we could actually perform it, mm-hmm. without a conductor.
Yes. About the harmonies, I must say, yeah. Of seeing the pictures, you have very, very obstinate chords.
Yeah, the dissonant loud chords. That was a total obsession.
Yeah,
and because like dissonance was such a big part of what I like in Varèse and also Messiaen, I mean those are the two colors that I really worked with, mm-hmm. or influenced me.
In the beginning of the piece, I think that the chords and the exchange of the two groups that HOKETUS is, of course, the doubled instrumentation, you see more attention for the piano players, and later on, as I see it, I got the impression that the attention is more back to the ensemble total.
Yeah, I think so, because during the composing of the piece, I got more and more at ease with the ensemble, and I wanted at the end to. That they all would play together, you know, not separated.
Okay.
But I haven't heard that piece since we performed it. So I've forgotten a lot.
Yeah. You don't listen your own music?
No, not in that sense. I mean, with electronic music, because I make it at home, I'm more. I remember it for a slightly longer time, but even the electronic CD I did in 2010, mm-hmm. I can't. Well, I would have to hear it again if I would really remember everything.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But that's also because I need to clear my head for the new stuff, mm-hmm. you know, or else it gets too cramped in here.
Mm. When you write a piece for HOKETUS, singing the pictures. And you are a member of it. Is it possible then to, well, you have written 5 minutes of music, that you rehearse it first and then continue the composing?
I think we must have tried some bits, but I'm not so sure how we did that with my piece. But I'm sure that people pointed out the mistakes and that I adapted in a positive way.
Okay. I think we should also talk maybe a little bit about the piece that you wrote for the ensemble that was refused, yeah. Camera Eye,
yeah.
79, if I'm well informed. Why was it refused?
Well, I think I've totally forgotten that piece. I think it was just bad, and it was totally unpractical. And I think it was really good that we came to our senses and threw it in the waste paper bin. And or like what Burroughs would say, tine it if something is good, and or if something is bad, tear it into tiny pieces and throw it into somebody else's garbage can.
Very so good.
That's what we did.
Okay.
It was good.
But do you think that you used aspects and elements of Camera Eye for singing the pictures?
I forgot. No idea.
Okay. Do you have memories about the performance of the piece?
It's
also a difficult piece.
Yeah, it's also difficult. But yeah. I think I remember one performance in a school, and we did this my piece, and there were very young people, I think. And after the first chord, I heard somebody say, "Hey, it's war again." all in all, I think we did good performances, and the response was also good. Of course, different from the minimal music pieces, but yeah, of course, it was another world that we presented.
But it was also a very difficult piece, I think, to play. It takes for about 17 minutes or so, yeah. And there are lots of silences where all the members have to count their asses off.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's. I mean, I'm sure you have. You must have rehearsed it hundreds of times before.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's not as difficult as other pieces we did.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Okay. Also a question about the role of Paul Cook.
Yeah.
If you see him play the piece in the farewell concert of Hoketus, you see him making, you can see him count.
Yeah. Yeah.
But he also is more or less a conductor, isn't that correct?
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's what we did with other pieces as well. I mean, of course, we had to cue one another.
Yeah.
That was our substitute for a conductor. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we did.
So is it correct that in that piece, all the musicians had to watch Paul?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. That was also part of our whole setup on stage, that we had to be able to see each other really well.
But is it also correct that you also do give signs?
I forgot again. I think I did, but yeah, I must have done. Mm. Yeah. So, you get less and less.
Very dissonant.
Yeah, yeah, very dissonant. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, let's round it off also, Huib. What are your memories about this piece and the way it is played? Is it a good memory?
Well, as I said, I've forgotten practically everything, but I think it was a good part of the Hoketus repertoire, although it was radically different from the rest. But it also had a function in that sense, and I think it was really good that the performance also could identify with this world. So I thought it was very, very good.
Huib Emmer, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Well, that was the first confrontation with the Huib's music, which is a very specific idea of making music. After that, I would play a lot of his pieces, uh-huh. And I love his way of making music. It's a very, very. He has a very specific sound as well, which was not the same sound as in HOKETUS. Even we were using the same instrument, but it was composed by a completely different way of thinking. I mean, his background was very different. He's, well, I could understand a couple of things of his taste. I mean, I know him now very well. So, but thinking back to the time, it was very, what you said, it was so different, because at the first time we used to play HOKETUS, which was, well, the basic thing, and but we played with play tam tam, which has a lot to do with sort of music that has nothing to do with swing, but it swings enormous, what we never could do with Louis Andriessen's music. You know, you're never allowed to play it with, you know, with swinging, and piece Tam Tam has this in a very natural way. I mean, Dieter Wagner is a very different composer, and he was much more about this swinging, and even if it's very contemporary sound and the piece, but it has a lot more to do with the sort of swing. And then on the other hand, we have this very strict Coming Together by Rutchevsky, which was, again, it was had more of this particular American way of feeling, you know, that what's much friendly as sound was, you know, this three piece, and then had with his seeing the pictures was completely different. It was very extreme. Had was particularly extreme in his ideas. Musical ideas, you know, his harmonies were very, very, very intense, and very his chords were very hard, very edgy.
Yeah.
You know, and like the whole piece was had this sort of extreme demands.
Yes. Would you say that you had the same physical experience in playing this piece, or was it physical less asking? How do you say that? Less involving for you?
Demanding.
Demanding. Yes.
Yeah. Of course, it was very different in a way. It was I wouldn't say easier to play, but it didn't have this. Well, it had nothing to do with trance. I mean, it had more to do with a certain form. So you had some rest here, and you know what were about blocks of so it was very different form. It was interesting to play, because there was another musical idea. So, and it was less demanding physically. Yeah. But I mean, I think any other piece was less demanding than HOKETUS. Maybe, perhaps, that Bint by Cornelis de Bont, probably, which was also very, you know, a sort of machine you put in movement and never stopped, but in a different tempo, like HOKETUS. Well, no other piece was so demanding as HOKETUS physically.
HUIB's piece is more. I always find that seeing the pictures was a different kind of room for HOKETUS. HUIB was not much interested in a minimal piece like you know, an ordinary minimal piece. He has his own language, and he looked for ways to, well, to use these instruments for his own good, and not like making a piece that is, you know, good for HOKETUS or something. Of course, good for HOKETUS, but not like in a certain style. It was in his own style, and I liked it very much. It's completely, you know, it has a kind of a rudeness. That I like very much. It's barren sometimes. It's, you know, but it's very, very clear and precise. And that was a piece that, you know, that is a language HOKETUS loves or can play or understands.
You could also say that this piece also has a very clear opinion about how Hoketus can sound.
Yes, well, that was, of course, his way of dealing with because you know, when you start a group, and I was there from the beginning, you wanted also to purpose to serve another goal of your own. It should be your own band in a way that you make your own music for, and that was very, I always liked it very much that there was also a different kind of style within Hoketus.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I think a more elegant piece, and so not as strict as Hoketus. Beautiful piece. Yeah, beautiful in that it was very well composed, and HUIB EMMER is a composer with a very personal and a beautiful approach, which is personal and well thought of, conceptual, and one of the more original composers of the Netherlands, I would say. And it was always a lot of fun playing his pieces. But also difficult pieces for a saxophone player.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why?
Playing a long tone on a saxophone, and then all those very differentiated little rhythmical cells was in a way a difficult combination. So let's say you have. Did you ever hear, let's say, Coltrane? And then suddenly he has to play 16th and then an eight note with dotted, and then two 16th. A discipline is in a way difficult to match with a very fearful sound.
Did HUIB know this? Specific saxophone things you think?
Well, we never talked about it. I think it was just my task, my job, to do what he as a composer liked. But you really can't play very dynamically, very sentimental in his pieces. Huh? So it's not about small, smooth movements. No, it's very strict and direct. And in fact, really, I always think I never played his piece as well, Although we were big friends. But I thought, what a mess. It's not good. Okay, but how to do that? And then the composer said, well, it's good. Okay, well, at a certain moment you have to stop. And then think, okay, well, the composer is satisfied and it's fine.
But you yourself were never satisfied?
No, because combining a certain aesthetics with his rhythmical approach and his melodic lines, I found it very difficult. I wasn't very satisfied with my own what I achieved, no.
But HUIB didn't have that disappointment.
He never expressed that to me. So, and we worked for a long time together, so I suppose he didn't.
He was all right about it.
Yeah.
For me, it was typical HUIB. One of the most beautiful guitar players I know. It was different.
What is so typically HUIB?
The intervals I liked very much. It was more architecture for me than the other pieces. Mm-hmm. It was more square-like than the other pieces. Block-wise, building up monumental buildings. Kaka-taka-kika, it was new music for me, really new music, which I could be so happy, because it felt really like huh? I've never heard this. And I've also never played this. What? And yeah, I like the sound very much. For me, was singing the picture was for me a step two in the HOKETUS development. Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, I presume step one is HOKETUS and Bint.
Yeah.
This is step two. In what way was it different from step one?
For me, it went. It had the possibility. HUIB showed me the possibility to develop with HOKETUS in a kind of future. Uh-huh. And that was not my feeling with Tam Tam. It was even not my feeling with Bint, because that was the same of what we already in a way did. And HUIB came with something with mixed up very well in the whole instrumentation in the group, very well. And it was a step for me to, we can go further. We can go further.
Here we could maybe see more connection to the Beefheart approach also.
I never thought about that. Yeah, maybe.
Because that's also in HUIB's music a lot maybe. Present, I think.
Even the theme already. Yeah. Never thought about that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was it also built up? So he wrote small parts of it, you rehearsed it, he went back and came back with more, or how did the process develop?
How I experienced it is we had a few talks about the instrumentation of the percussion, of yes. What I could use. Mm-hmm. But it was more with Gerard and Kees, with the piano players. They have also a very long solo in it. Yeah. And they were, at that time, they were very together with the three of them. So there was also something going on there. But a little bit different, we discuss also in the rehearsal room some what we called proefjes, and we played it. Yeah. Okay. And searching for the right gongs was a period of getting it right in the sound again. Yeah.
Thank you.